Happy Sunday. Amen. We're going to start this morning in the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 23. We're going to read verses 16 through 29. Jeremiah 23. Yahweh of armies says, "Don't listen to the words of the prophets who prophesy to you. They teach you vanity. They speak a vision of their own heart and not out of the mouth of Yahweh. They say continually to those who despise me, 'Yahweh has said, you shall have peace.' And to everyone who walks in the stubbornness of his own heart, they say, 'No evil shall come on you.' For who has stood in the counsel of Yahweh, that he should perceive and hear his word? Who has listened to my word and heard it? Behold, Yahweh's storm, his wrath, has gone out. Yes, a whirling storm. It shall burst on the head of the wicked. Yahweh's anger shall not return until he has executed and until he has performed the intents of his heart. In the latter days, you will understand it perfectly. I didn't send these prophets, yet they ran. I didn't speak to them, yet they prophesied. But if they had stood in my counsel, then they would have caused my people to hear my words and would have turned them from their evil way and from the evil of their doings. Am I a God at hand, says Yahweh, and not a God far off? Can anyone hide himself in secret places so that I can't see him, says Yahweh? Don't I fill heaven and earth, says Yahweh? I have heard what the prophets have said, who prophesy lies in my name, saying, 'I had a dream, I had a dream.' How long shall this be in the heart of the prophets who prophesy lies, even the prophets of the deceit of their own heart? They intend to cause my people to forget my name by their dreams, which they each tell his neighbor, as their fathers forgot my name because of Baal. The prophet who has a dream, let him tell a dream, and he who has my word, let him speak my word faithfully. What is the straw to the wheat, says Yahweh? Isn't my word like fire, says Yahweh, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces?" Amen. There's no substitutes. And we're going to read Psalm 26 next, Psalm of David. "Judge me, Yahweh, for I have walked in my integrity. I have trusted also in Yahweh without wavering. Examine me, Yahweh, and prove me. Try my heart and my mind, for your loving kindness is before my eyes. I have walked in your truth. I have not sat with deceitful men, neither will I go in with hypocrites. I hate the assembly of evildoers and will not sit with the wicked. I will wash my hands in innocence. So I will go about your altar, Yahweh, that I may make the voice of thanksgiving to be heard and tell of all your wondrous deeds. Yahweh, I love the habitation of your house, the place where your glory dwells. Don't gather my soul with sinners, nor my life with bloodthirsty men, in whose hands is wickedness. Their right hand is full of bribes. But as for me, I will walk in my integrity. Redeem me and be merciful to me. My foot stands in an even place. In the congregations, I will bless Yahweh." Amen. And our New Testament readings this morning will begin with Acts, the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20. And we'll read verses 27 through the end, verse 38. This is Paul speaking. I'll just start at verse 25, since that's where he starts. Now behold, I know that you all, among whom I went about preaching God's kingdom, will see my face no more. Therefore I testify to you today that I am clean from the blood of all men. For I didn't shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. Take heed, therefore, to yourselves and to all the flock, in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the assembly of the Lord and God, which he purchased with his own blood. For I know that after my departure, vicious wolves will enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Men will arise from your own selves, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore watch, remembering that for a period of 3 years I didn't cease to admonish everyone, night and day, with tears. Now, brothers, I entrust you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I coveted no one's silver or gold or clothing. You yourselves know that these hands served my necessities and those who are with me. In all things I gave you an example, that so laboring you ought to help the weak and to remember the words of the Lord Jesus, that he himself said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." When he had spoken these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all. They all wept a lot and fell on Paul's neck and kissed him, sorrowing most of all because of the word which he had spoken, that they should see his face no more. And they accompanied him to the ship. What a moment, amen. And we'll finish with the Gospel of Matthew today, chapter 7. We'll read 15 through 23. Can see the theme from today's reading here. This is the Lord speaking, and he says, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravening wolves. By their fruits you will know them. Do you gather grapes from thorns or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree produces good fruit, but the corrupt tree produces evil fruit. A good tree can't produce evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree produce good fruit. Every tree that doesn't grow good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them. Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will tell me in that day, 'Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name, in your name cast out demons, and in your name do many mighty works?' Then I will tell them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you who work iniquity.'" Let's not be counted with them, amen.
They said they did it, but he didn't.
Before we start, I want to apologize to those who are sitting near where I usually sit. I'm just allergic or sensitive to so many grooming products.
I'm going to put her in a bubble.
Yeah, even him.
Let's praise the Lord. Amen. Stand together and raise your hands and hearts toward heaven. Believe God for a wonderful demonstration of his glory. Taking Elaine's place today over there. Bless her heart, she had a shoulder replacement. Can you believe that? Shoulder replacement. And she's over 16. And it's supposed to double dip, but I think she... I think she's going to rethink the second one. She's not sure, but she has great range of motion now and movement. But she told me on the phone that she wasn't even up for a visit. She said that it was worse to her. The just everything about it. She said she feels worse than the other surgeries, and she's been through a bunch. So you never know how it's going to affect you. You know, but pray for Elaine. Pray for Jeff. Jeff's on the other side. Thank God. I want to think of him as a carp on the rack, you know, and they did a redo that he's good for another 100,000 miles. But he has a congenital, seems to be a congenital thing in their family, his father's side of the family. His brother died at 43 from a heart complaint, so it seems like it's hereditary. So, but I think I feel good about it. Did I tell you guys about the vision people had about Jeff Stephanopoulos? Did we tell you about him being an old man? How cool is that? I reminded him and his wife's there when I saw them, Sherry, about that. I had the dream about him being an old guy and all these kids, and they've already got grandkids, and I feel like it'll be great grandchildren. And then after I told him, he said about, I think it was 3 months earlier, one of his cousins had told him the same thing. She had a dream where he was an old geezer, long gray beard, and all these kids. So I thought that's the kind of thing you really want to take to the bank when you have a physical challenge, you know, when you've got inside information. So that's beautiful.
Hey Jeff, is that on volume 5? Just making sure.
Oh, you want to say praise the Lord? Praise the Lord.
Amen. Usually do.
Praise the Lord.
Praise Amen. The Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
He's my rock, my shield, my shield. He's my wheel of grace.
always think when we sing that song,
we're waiting for
that
you,
it sounds like we're treading water.
We're waiting for you, Master.
At the end there. We're not supposed to just wait in one place and just sit there and wait. We're supposed to occupy until he comes.
Part of that's praying, though.
I said, Holy Spirit, you need something help with me?
When you were praying?
Right.
When you got up to work, you started praying for the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
The Lord just wanted to walk up behind you and put his arms all around you.
I'll take it.
I'll take it, brother. Thank you. I'm glad Joe's here. I am. That was a good word. I told him I had some wacky things happen the other day in prayer, kind of a prophetic thing I share with Solomon a little bit. And I want to take those things, of course, same as you would, as you do. But it's a little bit outlandish, you know. I thought, well, you know what, Lord, I wouldn't mind if you kind of confirm some of this. I'll leave it up to you how you want to do it. And within a couple of days, this happened. That was way cool. And I'm glad to see Greg back. How many of you are glad to see Greg back? See the expression? Life is happening to him, just like we talked about Wednesday. I asked him if he had a visitor's card on the way in, you know, and he said, you don't want to be where I've been. But I got this guitar because he and Monica bought this for me. Isn't that nice?
Praise the Lord.
And I hadn't been here that long either.
Amen.
So they figured, that guy needs something. Let's get him a new one. Maybe it'll sound better, you know. Anyhow, but good to see you, Greg. I miss you and Monica whenever you're not here. Big time. I love this song. We couldn't find a rhythm that would work on that invisible drummer, so we just kind of tough it out. Amen. Anybody else got a word? Testimony? Anyone?
Anywhere?
Testimony. Now's the time. Speak now or forever feel bad. Anyone, anywhere? Christina, speak up, darling. No?
Lady,
Praise the Lord. Amen. Wow. She's ministering and her mother didn't even know it.
No.
Wow.
She just came in and
Awesome.
That's called being the Lord's voice and hands. Amen.
Thank you.
Praise God. I had to write a short screenplay about the Bible character Rahab, the deal she cut with the two spies regarding her family, because Jericho was under the ban. It was going to be laid siege to and destroyed. And I was thinking about when Joshua finally made the approach, an angel appeared before him. It was actually the angel of Yahweh with a flaming sword in his hand. And Joshua, I guess in ignorance, stupidly said, "Who are you for? Are you on our side or their side?" And the angel of the Lord said, "I represent Yahweh. I'm captain of the armies of Yahweh. Take off your shoes. The place you stand is holy ground." That would be like going to the worst part of Los Angeles and pronouncing it Jerusalem. It was the wickedest city of its age. People were worshiping Baal, the moon god. They were actually sacrificing their children in the fire to appease their cold, lifeless, powerless god, Baal. And yet, the Son of God, before he became man, as he visited Joshua in his pre-incarnate state, said, "The place you're standing on is holy ground." Isn't that something? Because the Lord is there. Anywhere we are is holy. Anywhere we are is holy. It doesn't matter whether it's the worst part of Los Angeles or New York, Sydney, Athens. It doesn't matter where it is. It could be the most polluted, spiritually polluted place in London. If Yahweh is there, it's holy. It's set apart. Praise God. He told the children of Israel, "Every place you place your foot, it belongs to you." All of that promised land was theirs. God's got a promised land for each one of us. And as we walk out His will in our lives, every place the sole of our foot treads is holy ground, and it's ours. I don't possess your portion. You don't possess mine. But we all have a walk. We all have a place. We all have an assignment. We all have a duty. And it's holy because God is there with us. Hallelujah. There used to be a temple. There used to be a holy of holies where the Shekinah glory of God would visit once a year on the Day of Atonement, and only over the blood of a clean animal sacrificed by the high priest of the day. Thank God. We have a better covenant established upon better promises, and we have a better fellowship and a better sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving than Israel ever had. And it's not once a year. It's every time we come together. The Shekinah glory of God, the manifested presence of the risen Christ, is available, is in with and under the bread and cup of the Lord's Supper. What a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful day. What a beautiful day to live, this day of grace, this age, the Holy Spirit, this church age. can dine on heavenly food.
Expecting.
Thank you, Jesus. We wait for you today, Lord. We wait for your arrival. Thank you for the bread and the cup that wait. Thank you for your people, Lord, that wait. Until we light the candles, pray the prayer of thanksgiving. Distribute these emblems. Have them received, and then as we repeat those wonderful words of institution that caused the miracle to happen, we thank you, Lord. We wait for you to inhabit that bread and that cup with your risen flesh and blood. Oh, we worship you, Lord. We worship you and thank you. Hallelujah. For making this place a holy place. Hallelujah. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord, for coming to us again today through revelations, through testimonies, Lord, through your manifested presence while we worship you, as the word, Lord, comes forth from your wonderful throne. And as we come round about your table, Lord, to touch you personally, spiritually, psychologically, emotionally, and literally and physically, Lord, we love you. We embrace you. We receive you as our all in all. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Praise God. Praise God. Raise your hearts and hands toward heaven this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Just release his presence today. If you're spirit filled this morning, release the beautiful prayer language of the Holy Spirit. Bless the Lord, O my soul, all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Your compassions fail not. They're new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Underneath are the everlasting arms. It's vain for us to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows, for you give to your beloved during sleep. Hallelujah. For dreams, Lord, and revelations, operations, manifestations, and how beautiful to watch them come to pass. Sometime the next morning, sometimes a week later, many times months, years later. You're the same yesterday and today and forever. You're Yahweh. You inhabit eternity and also the heart of the humble and contrite one. Praise God.
I hear the Lord saying, but a pardon of those in the spirit world. Mm. And there are those that I've sent around you to encamp you, protect you for those things that are about to come. And you can raise it up in strength and power that you do not know at this time is available to you.
Thank you.
That you will begin to see as the seers see, as the prophets saw, as those things that I've set before you are yours for my sake. They are yours for the crowns that you lay at my feet, and I will protect you until you come to the place where I will whisk you into my presence.
Hallelujah.
And you will see what the farthing that you see is flesh of this earth.
Amen.
So much more in the spirit.
Glory to Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord who forgives all our lawlessness, who heals all our diseases. Bless the Lord who crowns us with loving kindness and favor. Bless the Lord who renews our youth like the eagle. Bless the Lord, O my soul, all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Hallelujah. Praise your name, Jesus. Praise Yah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Glory be to Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can have a seat. Praise the Lord. God, thanks for coming out. Everything's pretty well current in the bulletin, as far as I know. A little note about Wednesday, however. We were going to do some end time second coming truths, and I talked to Solomon about kind of what I wanted to do, and he's listening, kind of nodding, and he says, sounds good, Dad, but 30 minutes? Really? And I thought about it, and I thought, you know what? Maybe we should make a little series out of this. So I think that's what we'll do. All different aspects of the second coming of Christ. And I think it'll hopefully be a real encouragement to people like you and me who live in the nasty now. How many live there? So it's very, very good news for God's people. The second coming and everything related to it is super good news for God's people. For those who don't know him, not so much. I was really touched by this. This is probably the third, maybe, or fourth email I've gotten from this brother. I think he's in, I know he's in Africa, but it might be Botswana, I'm not sure. His name's Thapelo. It is really good to have a sense of belonging. Now I feel like I belong to the Prophetic Voice Institute. As a full-time pastor, I now know who I am and what I'm capable of, both in ministry and in my community. Thank you very much. I wish there could be a way for you to mentor me more as my mentor passed away. Thank you very much. We need people like you in this world. Well, that's a good report. Amen. Better to leave a blessing than something else. How many have a Bible? Turn to the book of Philippians this morning, chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. We're going to read verses 11 through 14. And Bible study is very simple. Watch out. Watch out. Watch where you're going. Philippians chapter 3. I'm going to pick up the reading here in verse 11. This is Paul, of course, writing to the church in the city where he spent some time in the Hoosgow. What did he do? He delivered somebody from demons, and her owners didn't like it. Philippians, that's called suffering for righteousness' sake. Chapter 3, verses 11 through 14. Now let's go back to verse 10. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are ever before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I told you about my first car accident, just got my license. 16 years old, tooling around, little red Rambler. My friend Bernie waves, hey, Joe, I look over, hi, Bern, and that's where the car went, boom. And I was so disheartened. Like I walked home, you know, left the car there, radiator destroyed. All my mom and dad wanted to know was I okay? So I thought, that beats a blank. But my car followed my eyes. And in the spiritual inner realm, our life follows our eyes. What we look at and talk about captivates our attention. It will direct our steps. It will absolutely master our life. So a thought, reap an action. So an action, reap a habit. So a habit, reap a character. So a character, reap a destiny. It all begins with vision, particularly inner vision. And it's certainly illustrated by natural vision and what happens if we don't watch where we're going. Amen? Two things leap out at me in these couple of verses of Scripture, and that's what we want to think about today. Paul's goal and ours, hopefully. And then this concept of watching out or being aware of where we are and what we're doing, and hopefully looking to the Lord to help us through this life. As we just read, Paul has finished detailing what you and I would call his life statement, his life goal, his life mission. And his was three things, which we just read. To know Christ. This doesn't mean to know about him. Many people know about him. There are preachers today that don't know him, but know about him, who are preaching to people who don't know him, but know about him. And so nothing real is taking place because the Lord is not personally present to those people. Sad, isn't it? To know Christ. Secondly, the power of his resurrection. Would you agree with me that if God can bring a dead body out of the tomb after 3 days, he can probably take care of any needs you and I might have? Yeah. And Paul wanted to know that in a deeper measure, the power of the resurrection of Christ. And thirdly, the fellowship of his sufferings. How does that happen? How does this happen that we partner with him in his sufferings, that we know Christ and know his power evidenced in the resurrection? Paul tells us, continually conforming myself to his death. Now, what's that mean? Self-flagellation, you know, like Martin Luther beating his back with a little whip or crawling up the edifice steps, you know, on his knees. Is it what our friends in the Philippines do around Holy Week, where some of them go and march and lash themselves, others actually crucify themselves and allow their friends to carry them around? Is that what it means to be conformable to his death? No, of course not. What it means is to daily die to the flesh, to the natural man, and to live by means of the Holy Spirit, to basically say no on a daily basis to our fondness, to the world system, and to the devil, and yes, to God, his plan, his purpose, his provision for us. Are you tracking with me? Amen. And you can look at it like this, that Paul's running life's race, and he's got a clear and he's got a constant goal, and it's Christ. He begins the Christian life with the Lord. He plans on ending it with the Lord. That ought to be your testimony too, amen? What's at the end of the goal? Listen to him. If somehow I may arrive at the out resurrection, the one from among the dead ones. That's not spoken in uncertainty. He wasn't saying, oh man, if I just try with all my might and take all my spiritual vitamins, I sure hope I somehow maybe make it in. No, he's just speaking in humility. He's saying, if it were in any way up to me, I humbly wish that I can attain to this. Was he assured of it? Absolutely. The same apostle told you and me in the book of Romans, those of us that God foreknew ahead of time, he called. And those he called to himself, he justified, declared in right standing with himself. Watch it. And those he justified, he also glorified. The same apostle told the Ephesian church, you and I right now are sitting with Christ in heavenly places. He told the Colossian church, you and I and every believer died, and our present life stands hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is our life, is manifested, more on Wednesdays, we also will be manifested with him in glory. What do you mean the out resurrection, the one from among the dead ones? Exactly what his Savior said in John's Gospel, chapter 5, verse 28, 29. He said, there's coming a time when the dead are going to hear my voice, and those who hear are going to resurrect. They're going to come out of the grave. Some,
to the resurrection characterized by life. Who are they, Pastor? The ones who have done good. Those who have done evil, they will arise at the resurrection of judgment. Do you see the difference? It's not one resurrection of judgment where the good go into eternal life and the bad go south. It's two different resurrections altogether. The first resurrection is no judgment at all. It's unto life. You're raised to life, no judgment. The second resurrection is to judgment, the depth of your wrong deeds. Now, here's what some unfortunate people have done and unfortunate denominations have done. Those who have done good, resurrection characterized by life. Those who have done evil, a resurrection characterized by judgment. Oh, I hope my good deeds are more than my bad deeds, so I get this one rather than the other one. I hope I've done enough good so that I come to life rather than too much bad and wind up in judgment. How many are glad God gave us this book in Greek? If you have access to the text or an interlinear or you know someone who does, I think this is absolutely beatific. There is an article before each word. Those who have done the good, those who have done the bad, continually done the good thing, continually have done the bad thing. What's the good thing? Placing our faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. It's not a lot of good things piled up. Hopefully, they tip the scale in our direction. No, it's one good thing, and only one good thing that gets us into the resurrection characterized by life. Jesus told the most religious people of his day, unless you believe that I am, ego eimi, in other words, unless you believe that I am your God in the flesh, you'll die in your sins. Isn't that good news? And what's the bad thing that sends people to the resurrection characterized by judgment? Unbelief toward the Lord Jesus Christ. How many are glad you're a believer? So was Paul. This should be our goal too. It should be true of all believers, what Paul was looking at. But you know, there were some in the infant church who were proclaiming that they had reached a stage of perfection already in this life. Do you know what's still being taught? Yeah, about every generation, there will come a new group of believers with this heresy. It's called by different names, but the idea is you and I become perfect and complete expressions of our Savior in the here and now before the end of the age. Manifested sons of glory, different kinds of phrases for it. Every 40 years or so, it starts all over again. And it began in the time of Paul. There were some in the infant church who proclaimed that they had already reached perfection, and guess what? They were more than happy to tell other believers how to get there for a price. In our Bible reading today that Solomon read out of Acts, it talked about false teachers, ravenous wolves from outside coming into the church and causing trouble. And Paul said, also out of your own selves will people arise, speaking heresy, drawing people after themselves. That's the crowd that Solomon read about today in Matthew's gospel. The ones that are already in the church outwardly, but inwardly, they're not Christians. And they say they can do this, and they say they can do the other. And when the judgment for them comes, what's the Lord going to say? Depart from me, you who constantly work the lawlessness, unbelief toward me. I never at any time knew you. I don't want to be in that crowd. How about you? But there were some in the early church, and they were bothering this Philippian church. Listen to what Paul says in contrast to these false teachers that said, hey, I'm already here. Not that I have already received. Well, can you say amen to that? These Philippians knew Paul. He had preached in their city. He had really helped establish their church. I can just hear them saying as the letter's being read, duh, that would be right, Paul. When you were among us, you sure didn't look resurrected. I mean, if this is the resurrection, what you had, we want a refund. Maybe we'll rethink our salvation. Maybe we'll rethink our religion and which God we want to serve. Of course he hadn't reached the end and the out resurrection from among the dead ones. No one has yet, but it was being taught. Here's your homework, 2 Timothy 2:18. Paul said, some were teaching the resurrection has already happened. No new sins, no new heresies, just new sinners, just new false teachers. This stuff is as old as the gospel. Amen? Did you know that some were teaching to the Thessalonian church that the second coming had already happened? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 2. And that's still happening. How many of you remember one of our major American, good old U.S., made in the USA cults, made a change in their prophecies years ago? They had the Lord coming back in 1914. Guess what? It didn't happen. They weren't perfected. So what did they do? S-P-I-N. They decided to spin. Well, he did come, but it was spiritually. And so we've still got a while before he comes again physically. Unbelief and false doctrine always finds a way. Can you say amen? Yeah. Paul denied a place in maturity where he no longer expected to progress any further. Listen to him. Or already have permanently perfected myself. He said it hasn't happened. Hadn't happened for him. Wouldn't happen for the Philippians. Hasn't happened for you or me. Won't happen for any believer until we cross that finish line. Oh, yeah, we're changing on a daily basis. No argument there. From faith to a little greater faith. From our present experience of glory to a little greater one. But we have not yet crossed the finish line. So we've got the goal. Hopefully ours is like Paul, to know him, not just know about him, to know by experience the power of his resurrection, and to know how to be conformed to his sufferings, to say no to ourselves when God wants us to say no to the world system, no to the enemy, and yes to God. Hopefully that's our goal, just like Paul's, so that we wind up in a resurrection characterized by life rather than the other one. But what do we do in the meantime? What do we got for the nasty now? We've got some beautiful pie in the sky and the sweet by and by. Would you agree? You come on Wednesdays, you'll be reminded of just exactly how beautiful our future is. And I don't know about you, but I need good news about the future. I'm almost done watching even what I consider dependable news stations. Almost. I can't take too much of it. I just, small pieces. Because it's always bad. It's always doom. It's always gloom. It's always death, death, death. It's always tragedy. I quit watching the weather people years ago. I just don't do it anymore. Why? Because I feel like they're always scolding me, you know? If you go out, it could be hypothermia or death. It's a banner, you know? Wow. Pass. Hard pass. I think I'll just look at the sky, you know? I'll just look at the weather vane. I don't need you to scold me 24/7, you know? If you're making a trip, bring warm blankets and make sure your prescriptions have been refilled. What? What? Keep it here. We'll keep you informed. Keep it there. I wonder why. Why are you keeping me afraid? Why do you want me to hang on every word you say? Oh, wait a minute. That was just a commercial I saw on your station, wasn't it? Oh, so if I watch you, I will see that, and your company will make. Let's go to the present. Amen? Let's go to the present. Watch your step. Listen, our future is sorted for us. No problem. No problem. Take it to the bank. But the present, not so much. What's Paul doing in the present? But I am pursuing. I haven't already arrived, like some false teachers say we have, or they have. I haven't arrived. I'm pursuing. If I may also lay hold of that which I also was laid hold of by Christ Jesus. You know, this is actually a picture of somebody running after something. Pursuing. It's the same word translated persecution in the New Testament. When saints were persecuted, what was happening? They were being chased out. When they were persecuted in Jerusalem, the infant church, what happened? They got out of Dodge. Philip, for one, went out of Jerusalem down to Samaria. Boy, I bet the Samaritans were glad. Yeah? When he arrived, the devil left. The Bible says they were saved. They were water baptized, they were healed, they were delivered from devils, and there arose a great joy in the city. That one, Samaria, was oh so different to all the other cities round about them because God's man came. Why? Because he was chased out of Jerusalem. And boy, I bet they were glad he was chased out and brought the good news gospel of Jesus to that city and made their city shine like a diamond in the dust compared to all the unsaved communities round about them. Revival has a way of doing that. Revival has a way of changing the complexion, the spiritual complexion of an area. It doesn't matter what kind of area or what country it's in. He was chasing his goal. It's probably an athletic illustration or metaphor. You know, just like horses in a horse race will be just pounding down the track, and sometimes their jockeys, or maybe even they help, will try to edge other horses out of the way. And what are they looking at? Same thing you and I ought to be looking at. The goal, the ribbon, the prize, yeah? The gold cup, whatever it might be. And that's what you and I are looking for, aren't we? We're striving to edge out the competition to cross the goal so we can win the Derby or the Preakness or the Belmont. Or if you're a horse like Justified, you can win all three and you can enter that elite standing of thoroughbreds. But it's because of a goal. Now listen to Paul. Is this helping you guys? Boy, it helps me to see someone like Paul still living life one day at a time, still putting his pants on one leg at a time, still taking things one day at a time, still living in the now, in the present, forgetting what was back and reaching forth, but doing it in the present. Listen to him. Brothers, I myself. Now, if you got this letter, you would understand he's making it crystal clear. I am not like those false teachers that are selling DVDs and Blu-rays and CDs and so on to you to tell you how to be perfect in this age right now. I'm not like them. Listen to what he says. Ego, I, Paul, behold, I myself, ego, emafton, I myself am not considering to have permanently laid hold of God's calling for my life, which results in heaven. But what? Look at your Bible. Do you see that there is no verb after this thing or this? Do you see the word thing or the word, I should say, do? How many see the phrase I do? Do you see it's in italics? That means there's no verb in the text. All Paul said was this one thing. He didn't even really say I'm doing. Now you can certainly supply that. You can put PO there. Obviously that's what he's talking about. I'm doing this running. But it's somehow kind of more startling and graphic to hear him say, this thing. Not 100 million things I'm trying to do, but this one thing. If Satan cannot get you to stop pursuing God's goal for your life, do you know what he'll do? He'll give you another goal. If he can't stop you from pursuing the goal of God for your life, finishing your particular race, he'll distract you by trying to give you another one. But he never quits. And Paul said, not me. I've got one thing in mind, what I just talked about. Language is so bold. Think about it. If a believer like Paul, with his spiritual stature, is humble and still on the chase, these believers and you and I have no need to waste time or money supporting false prophets and teachers who are telling us otherwise. And this is Paul's final advice. Watch out. What he talks about here is what I call the precious present. There's a little book I would like to recommend to you. It's not a Christian book. It's just a very, very good book about life. It's written by Spencer Johnson, who's an Irish physician, best-selling author. He co-authored The One-Minute Manager back years and years ago, and a whole slew of other books along the same line. It's called The Present. You can read it in one sitting. And I would venture to say when you're done with that book, you'll be glad you read it. You'll say, oh, I'm glad I spent that. I never thought of it. It's a play on words, the present. It's a gift, and it's also a place. Yes? It's a place. The present is where we are. It's where we really live. Nothing else is real. Nothing else exists anymore, does it? It's not real. The only place that's real is now. Someone says to me, well, I'm lonely right now. And I feel like I've always been lonely, and I feel like I'll always be lonely. You know what? Not necessarily. And sometimes for a lonely person, the solution isn't to have a person or a relationship. Sometimes it's to have a goal or a pursuit. Somebody that's pursuing something is usually not as lonely as someone else without people in their lives who's not in hot pursuit of something. I watched a documentary about Albert Einstein. Did you know he was still pursuing discoveries when he died in his late 70s? Someone asked him if he believed in God. He said, yes. Do you believe God created the universe? He said, yes, I believe God created the universe. My job is just to find out how. And that's where he spent his life. As an older man, he was still pursuing. He was in such pursuit that even surrounded by people, you know, maybe to his fault, he didn't even recognize they were there a lot, didn't give enough attention to his family, et cetera, according to his family. But he was in hot pursuit. Difficult to drive well while you're looking backward, isn't it? If you're always looking in the rearview mirror, you're going to miss what's in front of you. If you let something to the side distract you and look there, that's where you're going to go in the car. So will your life be. If God's told you to do this and you allow someone to distract you into doing that, that's where you're going to wind up rather than there. See, I don't think God wants us to be mechanical men, you know, walking around in this hypnosis put on us by life. You know, the world says jump and we automatically say, how high? Where? Choose us by that. God wants us to be awake and aware, and we can't do that if we're constantly looking back or constantly looking forward in the wrong way, you know, worrying. We need to live in the here and now, don't we? You know, I've had some, I think, wonderful success in this little therapy that I do. Why? The basis of the therapy is to break the habit, the thought habit, of meeting life in the present based on past traumas. The goal of the therapy is to file the emotions of those traumas back there where they originated rather than carrying them around. This attitude, for Paul, is Christian maturity. Someone whose idea about life is to know Christ better experientially, to know the power of his resurrection in a deeper way, to know the fellowship of his sufferings by, on a daily basis, saying no to the world, the flesh, and the devil, yes to God and God's will. Person that realizes that Christian life is linear. It's not circular. It's linear. It's going somewhere. There's a finish line, and Jesus is already there, and the crown's already there, and the glory party's already there. Only thing they're waiting for is you. Only thing they're waiting for is me. And Paul finishes this by telling the Philippians, if you're thinking about life in any other way, if someone has given you any other goal, if you have mistakenly adopted someone else's view of what your life should be and what you should be, do, and have, God's faithful, he will reveal even that to you. He will show you where you're being distracted. He will show me where I'm missing his perfect will. He will reveal to us whatever it is that we need to know. God's word for this week: watch out. Father, thank you. Thank you for this wake-up call, this course correction to remind us to watch our steps. Step out from under the hypnosis of life in a fallen world and live awake and aware as believers in the here and now, taking advantage of the time we have to be your voice and your hand extended to people in need. Thanks, Lord, for showing us many times supernaturally where we're wasting time or where we're not laying hold of what you've given us. Thanks, Lord, for messages and sentences in your Bible and stories in the scripture and people whose lives resonate with your wonderful truth. Thanks, Father, for another day and another week to course correct, to remind ourselves where we came from, why we're here, and where we're going. Help us, Lord, to discard anything that would hold us back or weigh us down. Fine-tune our hearing to tune out the voice of the world system that hammers and yammers, and tune in to your sweet, small, still voice. This is the way. Walk in it. Let your divine peace, Lord, monitor all our steps here and hereafter. And we thank you in advance for the victory parade that awaits anyone and everyone who knows you personally as Savior and Lord. Thank you, Lord, for those of us who don't live to your second coming, for this resurrection that is ours, one characterized by life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for who you are and what you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
May this life that I live bring you praise, blessing you and your wonderful way. In the work of my hands and the words that I say, I will worship you, Lord, all my days. I will sing to you.
For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take and eat, for this is my body, which is being broken for you. Do this in memory of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after the supper and said, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. Do this as often as you drink in memory of me."
just like to do what God wants to do. Amen. Praise God. Let's bow our heads and bow our hearts today. It's been a wonderful time in your presence, Lord. Thank you for the Spirit of the Lord being alive and well among us. Thank you for spiritual dreams. Thank you for revelations, Lord. Thank you for prophetic words. Thank you for impressions and intuitions. Thank you that you're so present, so alive, so well. Bless your holy name, Lord. Bless your holy name. Thank you, Lord, for still being present on this altar. It's awesome to be in your presence, to know you're here. Kind of like this to last forever, but we know it can't, Lord. But thank you for coming again at this service, at this time, in this hour, on this day, to this group of people. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Yahweh, may he bless you and protect you. Yahweh, may he make his face shine on you and be gracious, merciful, and compassionate toward you. Yahweh, may he lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his shalom. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Good to know angels have been here today. Amen. Hallelujah. He's awesome. Praise the Lord. There's some coffee out there. There's some coffee out there. Remind your friends, the messages are always available on download and also Facebook and YouTube. I don't know if there's any fruit, but there's something out there, sweet.